Well, you know, it should be visually powerful in the sense that I do not like design that is a flat tire, that has no tension, that has no guts, that has no expression, you know. This doesn't mean to be boom like this. It could be, on the contrary, extremely elegant. And by that I mean intellectually elegant, you know, not fashion elegant, not Morris elegant. But just intellectually elegant, that means a mind that has been cultivated and refined for quite a long time, you know, reading the best kind of books and really understanding how mind could be sublime, you know. And is a, you know what, intellectually elegance is exactly the opposite of intellectually vulgar, you know. And indeed, we are surrounded by a tremendous amount of vulgarity. Therefore, it is a strive to, you know, it is an effort to change that kind of situation. But it's very exciting because you have a sense of accomplishment, you know. And of course, you like to talk about, you like to convince people, and tell people how to get away from vulgar, you know, situations into something which is a little more elegant, a little more refined. And if you multiply, then the world is beginning to get better. It takes a long time, however. Then the third thing is people are fascinated with trends. You know, trends are in the air. Everybody likes to be trendy, to be up to date, you know. But it's up to date today and it's gone tomorrow, you know. And if you are a responsible kind of a designer, you cannot design things that tomorrow are no good anymore. You know, you feel like cheating with your client and your public or your user, whatever it might be, you know. So you like to design something that is going to last a long time. And so you train yourself to be disciplined and you train yourself to stay away from trends, you know. And in a sense, you get automatically involved into the notion of timelessness. So things that last a long time. And my God, I can quote so many things. Let's say American Airlines logo I've done, you know, look how many have been done since I've done that one. I've done that 45 years ago, maybe even 50 years ago. And it's still there. It's the only one that's never changed. How you can change, how can you make it better? It's very legible. There's no tricks. It's half red, half blue. You know? What is more American than that? You give me one and I'll take a look. You know, the type is the type that will last forever, you know, and it's fine. Got so many Bloomingdale logo or a New York Subway or, you know, I mean, plenty of things, you know, which are... and objects we have done, you know, plates like the Heller plates, the, you know, generations after generation grew up by eating on those plates, and they're still around today. furniture that we have designed, you know, a long time ago, they're still there, and so on. So it is great to design things that stay a long time. They have a long staying power. And when you look at the antiques, well, they have a staying power, you know. So I kind of like the idea of designing things that 100 years from now will be looked with respect and not laughed about, you know, in a sense. Well, vulgarity is really the real ubiquitous thing, you know. Vulgarity is on everything, in clothing today, more than ever, is on printed matter, you know, cartoonish kind of things, balloons. Even the subway map has all those balloons. I mean, that's very low literary level. There is no need. You don't talk down to people. You talk up to people. You know, and that is the thing. So instead, most of the people, most of the manufacturers, they tend to design things to sell. They're more interested in the money side than anything else. And greed is really the religion of vulgarity, you know. And that is that kind of greed, you know, which everybody seems to have as part of a culture, more than any other place to a certain extent, maybe because it offers more, maybe because there's more buying power in the people. God knows, I don't know why, but certainly is. And you know why also? Because it's a very young country, hasn't had the time to sift what is good from what is bad, you know. But like everything that is young is fascinating. You know? Well, number one, we like to design things which were bad before, so we have a challenge to make it better. The other thing, all the maps which were done at the time before our map, you know, were naive to a certain extent, you know, but we took a different. They were trying to be half geographic, half schematic, you know, and so on. Not very clear idea. And instead, we took a very precise diagrammatic kind of approach, a diagram based on a grid of, 90 and 45 degrees, like the London map, which was there in 1931, you know, a long time ago. And we just did it. You know, every line had a color at the time. Every station had a dot, no station. It's very simple, you know. And very simple, however, is a process of sifting until you get just the essentials, you know, and all the trashy things are gone, you know. And that is a process that is typical of our modus operandi. I mean, what we do all the time, sifting. Actually, I'm not a designer, I'm a sifter. You know, I keep sifting everything, you know, all the time. My sift never ends. It keeps shaking all the time for everything that is around. And so that is the way it goes. In 1979, they changed the nomenclature, so the map that we had done was not good anymore for use. And so recently we redesigned the map according to the new nomenclature. So that's what we have done. It's kind of nice. It's already in so many museums that I can't believe it. And I hope we will do something with it soon, you know. So it's a good map. But most of the maps today, they are done this way, subway maps. I mean, around the world, Paris has done a new one like this some time ago, Berlin, you name it, every major city uses diagrammatic map. It's only New York, which is kind of special. It still has this sort of a hybrid between, you know, a map and a diagram, but not even a diagram, not even a map, you know. But however, the problem with the existing map is too much information. It's a 5 pounds into a 1 pound bag, and no wonder it breaks. Well, we designed the signs for the historical district, the historical street. And what we did that, you see, again, you have to be aware of what is around. For instance, we could have done a completely new, different sign, but that would have been stupid. As a matter of fact, somebody else did that kind of a thing, and I consider it a very stupid approach, because that what it does, it adds to already very busy clutter. So instead, we took the existing sign, just changed the color. You know, so not only is it inexpensive to do it that way, but also it doesn't add another layer to the already very busy urban clutter, you know. So the problem of clutter is a big one, of course, as a designer, and sifting, we try to sift out, you know, as much as possible, it's even in that kind of stuff. Yeah, you know, you have to know that, like every good designer, you know, you have a twin brother that is called ego, you know. And I go around with my ego all the time, and you should see how happy he is when he goes around in a most, you know, far away kind of place, and all of a sudden maybe a truck comes by with a logo that you have designed, or a book is on the window of a store, or some place has the furniture that you have designed, or the airline that brings you there has that. So it's kind of fun, yes, it is a lot of fun. Well, it's a gratification. It's a lifelong gratification. You know, but as I said, it's for my ego, to keep my ego happy. You know, if the ego is not happy, you're in deep trouble, you know that. Well, you know, you have to know a little more about the history of typography or type, how it came about, you know. You know, it was invented at the end of the 1400, you know, the Gutenberg, so to speak. And then for, 200 or 300 years, it went with very few different typefaces, you know, very elegant, and that's it. Some publisher had the type, and printer and publisher was all one thing, you know. And there were very few, also because it was very difficult to cut type, you know. It was cut by hand and no tools beside the chisel, so to speak, you know, and the type was small, you know. So it was a very refined kind of operation to do. And because it was refined, it was also quite elegant, you know. There was no room for vulgarity to get into it. So the basic typefaces done in those years, like Garamond, like Baskerville, Granger, and so on, Caslon, they were quite elegant, very elegant, actually, typefaces. Then the Industrial Revolution comes about, and then you can do the type in an industrial way, and, you know, with help of machines and so on and so forth, you know. And then, because you could do it, people start to do it. The foundry start to do more type, and therefore they had to sell it, to offer it. And they found the right victim into the advertising people, which they thought that they should use a different typeface for every different client. They should not have two clients with the same type. God. And so that went on and on. It became a business, just like wallpapers, you know, and it became a business to make typefaces. And then because of that, you got typefaces designers, people that got into the business, they like it, and they create nonsense type, things that were totally useless, you know, and things of that nature, and on and on and on and on. And so eventually, you understand that the reason there are a lot of typefaces is just because it's a business, not a need. So you begin to sift. You begin sifting, and to see which one are appropriate for one use or another. And basically, as you know, the typefaces, they divide in two categories, which are called serif, the one with the feet, and sans serif, without the feet, the straight one. And between one family and the other family, you begin to pick up the best. And at the end, when you pick up the best, you wind up with about half a dozen or a little more of typefaces, you know. And those are good for everything. Each one of those families are very large, you know, so there are of the same typeface you have, very thin or very big, very straight or italic, which is inclined, you know, things like that. So the, yes, there are only good, maybe a dozen. I'm very generous today, St. Patrick's Day, you know, but there is no more than a dozen. Actually, I don't use many more than three or four in my life, you know, that is the thing. However, exceptionally, sometimes I might use some other two, but there is really not much more than a dozen of good typefaces, and the rest you can really trash it, you know. However, I mean, from a design point of view, however, it's a business that keeps a lot of people alive, and what do you want to do? What they will do otherwise. So let them do type if they like it. You know, the only thing that is important to understand is when to use it and when not to use it, you know, or what to use, you know. And that good designer can come to it, you know. And they can live very well along with very few typefaces. Every good designer doesn't use more than few typefaces. And when they're less good, the number increases. And if they're worse, they use all of them. Definitely, I was surprised and very, very, very pleased too. But it's incredible how many people really like the movie, people that have nothing to do with design, and how useful it has been. You have no idea the amount of people that mentioned this movie to me, you know, everywhere in the world. I got email from everywhere in the world, you know, talking about it. I don't say many things. In the disc, if you get the disc, at the end there are extras, which are better than the whole movie, really. They're terrific. So if you get the disc, it's fine. Anyhow, that is good. You see, Helvetica was born in 1957, you know, around that time, 55, for a very precise reason. I remember before Helvetica, I was using similar typefaces and cutting together close, because we like type to be closed, you know. But typefaces, they came with shoulders. And at that time, you know, and the great invention of Helvetica was to make a shoulder very, very tight. So you could put the type straight. And it's the only type that had that. That's why. When we had that type that we could do that, that was BC, before a computer. Now with a computer, you can even do that. You know, you can do anything. But at the time, it had to be done by cutting, you know. And so I lost a lot of type, a lot of letters by cutting and gluing and so on. But when Helvetica came about, that could be done fine. And that is why it was so successful. And I started to use and use it. The more you use, the more you learn how to use it. It's just like a piano. The more you play it, the more you know, you learn how to play it. And the better player you become. And so is with the type. You know, and it is a great typeface. It will last forever. You know, there are others. Some people like other variations of it. You know, I'm happy with that. You know, and I think it will last hundreds of years. You know, until people will write, at least, along with the Bodoni, along with the Garamond. You know, along with the few of the great classic typefaces. You know, and that's it. Until we write, those faces will be around, I guess.
This is a very interesting project that the Vignellis did for Heller Company. Production of these plastic cups, and they come in, as you can see, in a rainbow of colors. There's interesting history behind the development of these cups in terms of Massimo's original kind of European design with an open thumb area, and then the fact that it had to be closed up in production because people were pouring the coffee up to the top of the cups and it was going all down the handle and into the, onto the table. And so it's been kind of a fun piece of history here. This next slide is relates to the Heller cups.
Yeah, this is actually a letter from 1972 where MoMA was accepting the cup with the hole into their collection as part of their design collections. And there's actually a really great carbon copy of the response to this letter where Massimo thanks them very graciously for putting it in their collection and also kind of encourages MoMA to do more promotion of design.
Yeah, this is a wonderful example, though, of what we mean by an archive and artifacts, because here's a letter that was part of the history of this particular project. And it just gives us the detail of that one aspect of that particular project. We're going to look now at a kind of an array of different Vignelli projects over the years, just to give you a feel for some of the range of the work. Here we have some posters. The one on the left is actually one that was done when the Vignellis were still in Italy. The posters range from different exhibits. So there's one on the right from the Fort Worth Art Museum. So a poster is one form of which the Vignellis have been active in terms of their creative output. And of course, I think everyone recognizes this. This is the brand for the American Airlines, which actually has just been replaced or revised. But we at RIT look back on this original project as being seminal and really a timeless example of Vignelli work. This is from 1967. And in this project, Massimo used the typeface Helvetica and popularized that, a very simple logo with American in red, of course, and Airlines in blue, and so he's taking advantage of the patriotic color symbolism here. And here's some additional graphic work, sometimes typographic, sometimes a mixture of image and type. Again, Massimo is one that specializes more in the graphic output, I guess, over the years. This is some graphic work for the International Design Center in New York and for the Knoll Furniture Company. They've done some considerable work for Knoll, and Knoll actually carries some of the Vignelli furniture, including the handkerchief chair, which we'll see in a moment. And this is a very famous poster that the Vignellis did for Knoll in 1966, these transparent colors. But this represents, I think, the unique and dynamic aspect of the of Vignelli design.
And here you can see a piece from the archives. It's actually a little booklet. I don't know if you can tell from the slide. It's stapled down the side, and it shows a two-page layout for an exhibition catalog that they did for Knoll. Knoll had an exhibition at the Louvre in 1971, and they also did the exhibition design. But you can see that this is Massimo's hand drawing each two-page layout, and if we could turn each page, you would see that. And then if we go to the next slide, you can see then there's a more refined version showing the same things, and you see that distinctive Knoll logo that, you know, even in a sketch, he takes the time to show us that Helvetica.
So one of the real benefits of an archive, and in this case, is that we can see the student or the researcher, anyone who's delving into this material, can get a real feel for the process by which the designer has worked, the way of thinking through a project from beginning basically to end. And we would have pieces, or we would have artifacts, we call them, for each stage in this process. And this is especially valuable with Vignelli because his hand is so great in terms of drawing, and it's really just a lesson for students in looking at his sketches and his drawing. Again, another medium in which the Vignellis have worked is calendars, and this shows several of their calendar designs. The one in the background with the white background is actually the famous Stendig calendar, and this was from the late 60s. The one in the front with a 23 is actually a modular calendar that is still on the market. One can still purchase these. I know that they're available at design shops in major cities and major galleries. The Stendig calendar is really huge. It's really quite big and really commands a wall. It's really almost like a piece of art in that the relationship of these letters in terms of the positive and negative shapes really is almost like dealing with sculpture.
And here's another example of something that you might find in the archives. This is an Italian catalog with some designers' works that were selling. This is actually a company, NAVA, NAVA, I don't know if that stands for something, showing both the Stendig and the Heller calendar that came in this envelope is what you see in the back. So it had numerous designers.
Yeah, Vignelli's were part of a large design organization called Unimark International, which really for many years in the 70s was the largest design company in the world. That situation went on for a long time with great projects coming out, and then eventually it morphed in back into the Vignelli Associates, which is their own company. This is actually one of their more famous projects. This was done for the National Park Service, and these are all examples of brochures that exist at national parks, which the visitor can get information and maps and so forth. But the key thing about this project is that the Vignellis designed it as an information system. These different brochures, and so there's a sense of unity, a sense of predictability that exists as you go from Yosemite to Yellowstone to Joshua Tree National Monument in California. You'll find the same general kind of layout, and this reflects the fact that the Vignellis designed a rational, objective system for brochure design and handed it over to the National Park Service. This is probably one of their most famous designs. This is the original subway map for the New York City Metro. This was accomplished first in 1970 or around then, and was really quite controversial. It was based on the idea of the London Underground, which is an abstraction. This is really, he called it a map. And I think many people felt that it was a normal map, when really it was a diagram of the subway lines. And because of its abstraction and because of its other features, like the fact that the river is brown and not blue, this map became very, very controversial and was pulled from use after a while, and a more traditional map was used. So it's really become kind of a collector's icon. But it's interesting to note that he, in 2003, he came out with a new version of this map, which has been updated, and now he calls it a diagram. This was a standards manual that Vignelli Associates put together for the graphics of the New York City Subway Transit Authority. And this is a way of establishing graphic standards for this, for the making of signs and other pieces of information for the subway. This is all still in use and still very functional.
And here's another example of some of the materials we have that relate to the graphics designs that he did for the subway. This is just simply the signs without any content on them, but you can recognize that stripe across the top as being part of the New York subway system. And this is on a presentation board that would have been used to, you know, probably show them some examples of how they can do their design work. I want to just interrupt for one moment because we have two comments. One from Bruce H., who says that the Aramark used that same exact cup design at Xerox for reusable mugs to cut down on waste stream. He says he still has the mug, so thanks, Bruce. And from Paul Martin, the event is awesome. I hope you plan to do this regularly. We will try and do that for you, Paul. Thanks so much for your thoughts.
Okay, moving right along. One of the interesting projects that Vignelli's accomplished was in 1972, a branding project for Bloomingdale's department store in New York. And the central idea here was an array, a system of bright colored packages and bags and so forth, and then a very unique logo in which the two O's in Bloomingdale's were overlapped. And then again, this shows the range of their work. You can see here, this is some graphics for Cinzano in some of their packaging. And speaking of range, here we're looking at some watches designed by the Vignellis. They started the watch design project in 1994, and these are some of their more contemporary watches. These are produced by Pierre Junot in Switzerland. This is actually one of the more famous watch designs, in which one obtains with the watch, one obtains a series of different colored rings that you can change, which become interchangeable. And I think the watch design itself is very symbolic, I think, of the Vignelli's work in general. And that is very functional and basic and simple, and is not cluttered up with all kinds of decoration. Decoration would really be the antithesis of Vignelli design.
And here's a drawing example from 1993 of some watch ideas. Let me get a little bit of a side view to show how thin the face of the watch is, and then some different color choices. But this is sort of the example, like sometimes you see, I'm not sure if this watch ever was in production, or this could be an early idea for the watch. You know, those are things we're still discovering as far as looking through the archives. Same with this watch. I don't know if this design exists. I don't know if you know, Roger, but this one's a little bit later, 96.
Yeah, I don't think that they actually produced this one. And again, moving to a completely different genre, here we're talking about a very special project beginning in the early 90s, in which the Vignellis were kind of frustrated with having to buy neckties of different widths and sports jackets of different styles and so forth. And so they decided, another one of their slogans is, if we can't find something, we design it. And so they designed their own line of clothes. And here we see Massimo in one of his outfits. They had at one point a full-time tailor working at their design office on 10th Avenue.
And in addition to having a huge rack full of patterns for the clothing, unfortunately I don't have a picture of that, we have some of the early thoughts on it. And notice that they call it a clothing system. They're not calling it fashion design because they're sort of trying to step away from fashion and make something that's timeless.
Yeah, Massimo really likes to make a very strong distinction between between his work and style, and he doesn't really believe that that modernist design that he practices really has anything to do with style. Their work represents what we would call a modernist, rational, objective approach to design. It's not the only way to design, but it certainly is a very distinctive part of their work.
And here you see one of their drafts for where they're saying, you know, there's a need for this kind of clothing and going through the timeless and, you know, sort of the things Roger was just saying, like not at every whim of fashion. And you can see this draft where they've crossed out some of the ideas they thought weren't appropriate, and we do have a later version where it's typewritten that you can, so you can see this sort of thought process going into this, these concepts. And then here's one of the sketches where you can see we also get a very geometric drawing of it, but again, it says systems, and this is just the basic combinations, and then there are other items that go into this, but these are some really early ideas from the 70s, and they didn't actually realize any of the clothes until the 90s.
Again, moving to a completely different form, here we have some tableware, and in fact, Massimo, when he first came to the U.S., and they worked for several years in Newburyport, Massachusetts, working for a company designing silverware. And this particular design, I think, was produced for a hotel. As was this. This is the famous Chiga glassware, and there were a set of glasses, different size glasses, and other forms of glass that were used for this hotel. This is based on the story behind this kind of curved glass. Massimo was sitting on the Grand Canal in Venice, talking to the client, looking across the canal, and the client was asking Massimo what he saw as the shape of the glassware to come, and Massimo says, "Well, it's going to follow the curve on that wonderful church across the way," and that's exactly what we see here in this particular flask. And this is the Sasaki tableware collection. And
here's again, you can see sort of the process here. You can see some sketches of the different shapes. Some ideas about color, you can see things that were considered and crossed out. You get, again, into the design process of the final, what you end up with.
And again, you know, we move here to their furniture. This is their, called their handkerchief chair, which is still being sold by Noel. And it obviously comes in different colors. It's quite comfortable. We're very fortunate at the Vignelli Center. We have a conference room with only these chairs, and so we live with them every day.
And here's a box. This is just how we found the box. We opened it and found a pencil still in the box from when he was sketching, and it's obviously some really early, just quick shape line drawings of the chair, but you can already see how much the shape of it is similar to what he ends up with. And here, the little white model of the chair is the handkerchief chair, but it's with some Bertoia side chairs that these were going to be child-sized versions, according to the archives, that were never produced by Noel, but they considered making child-sized versions of these chairs, which was.
Yeah, we call these three-dimensional, we call these maquettes.
And here's another, advanced copy as opposed to a handmade one that was considered for the Vitro Museum, make small scale models of famous design chairs, and so they were considering doing the handkerchief chair. I don't know the whole story, but here we have a version of it. As far as I know, it was never made, but maybe that will change.
And this is the March chair.
It is March.
Quite timely.
And here you can see there's some Polaroid photos, the array of them, that some of the different with arms, without arms. We have a number of different versions of the actual chair, different prototypes and final versions of the chair in the archives. But and then the next slide shows you a little sketches of them stacked up.
The Vignellis moved in the 1970s to a wonderful office on 10th Avenue. Okay. This is the another one of the Vignelli chair designs. Want to speak to this one, Jennifer?
This is the interview chair from Poltrona Frau. I think this was done in 1988. Right. I think there's a story that goes with the whole interview part of it. It's something to do with a TV station. Unfortunately, I'm forgetting the story now.
Yeah, this was in Italy, and they've done a considerable amount of Poltrona Frau, the Italian furniture company, was one of their major clients for many years. This again shows you the range of their work. This is a showroom design for a company in California named Heuserman. And the unique thing about this was that the company produces office systems and wall systems. And so they use very bright colors in trying to present these different wall designs. This is actually one of my favorite projects, this small, I don't know if you'd call it a coffee table, it comes in several sizes, but it's called Metafora number one, and Massimo had a friend in Italy who owned a marble quarry, and he said to Massimo, can you make something with some of my marble? And so out of that came a number of tables and so forth. And again, here you can see the basic geometric forms of the, and these would be the basic forms that would be of interest to the modernist designer like the Vignellis.
And here you can see, here's again, sort of an ephemeral piece that would be hard to track down anywhere, but they've held on to this catalog just about the Metafora number one table, which has some really nice photographs of it. And it's also, this particular piece is interesting to me as an archivist, as I'm used to dealing more with papers. And now we have large marble objects that we have to think about storing and displaying. And luckily, they're very stable material.
But this, it's interesting, when these Metafora tables were installed at the center, Massimo was there, and he was down on his hands and knees arranging the objects underneath the glass so that they're in the perfect place for him. That's the kind of concern he would have for detail. And this is another one of the of tables from that period with a large piece of marble as part of the support system. This is another aspect of Vignelli's work. They've done a considerable amount of branding design, and this is one of their BK designs that they've produced. The idea here is that one develops a strong graphic mark and a typographic style, that their standards were developed so that there could be a great deal of consistency in the way that the image of the company and the brand appears, from business cards to brochures to the front of the building itself. And this is one of their more recent projects. This is the branding project for the Woolworth Company. This is a company in South Africa, runs a series of large food stores, and it's basically about as simple as one can get. It's just a square with a sans serif W in the center, And it's just the whole branding program, the whole system is just fabulous in terms of how this simple graphic approach can permeate every product that they produce. And here you can see some of the products that they have. So it's typographic. And then this is a more recent project. This is a application of the new subway map, but this is for the Metropolitan Transit Authority in New York, and this is an online program. It's called the Weekender, and the subway user can go online and check into this electronic version of the Vignelli map and see what lines are running on a given day of the weekend, which lines are not running, et cetera. So this moves them really well into the digital age.
Let me interject for another question or two. We have one from Vladimir Wurlow. He says there was quite a progressive movement of modernism and design, not only in graphics, but in all disciplines in the 60s and 70s. Seemed to end around the Reagan era, and in my opinion, it even had gone backwards. During my last visit to RIT, I was sad to see only a few remnants of this era, in particular some partial tracings of the RIT logo that you, I believe that you, Roger, designed in one of the doors. And this is a question for you, Roger. Do you feel that this era of progressive modernism will ever come back?
Well, I remember you, Vladimir. I think it was Walter at the time. And I'm so glad to reconnect with you this way. This would take a whole webinar to deal with this question, but I think you've really put your finger on a very important point, because Massimo Vignelli and Lella Vignelli and I and others really believe that the whole world of modernism really hasn't gone away, but that it's still very much alive, and that it's survived the critical view of the postmodern period of deconstructionism and so forth, and the values of modernism, the design values that the Vignelli stand for, really are still very much alive. And I like to think that the Vignelli Center for Design Studies exists partly to keep this kind of approach and keep these kind of values present in the education of young designers. I asked Massimo at one point to sign one of his books for me in my own collection, and he signed the book and he wrote, "To Roger Remington, the High Priest of Modernism from a Lowly Apostle." So we both share this strong opinion about this, and it's again a very debatable opinion in terms of the role of modernism, but I think I like to think that modernism itself has kind of evolved now into what I would call a neo-modernism, or a new phase that's come out as we've weathered the storms of postmodernism.
And we thank you for the suggestion for our next webinar with Roger. We have two questions that we're going to combine because they're very similar, from Paulina Reed and from Paul Martin. Both ask if you're aware of items that are missing from the Vignelli collection, either because they were deeply personal and appreciated and loved by Massimo or Lella, or if for some other reason there's something significant from the collection that we do not have.
That's a great question, and I don't know because I haven't processed the whole collection yet. I don't know. As far as I know, there aren't any stories about anything they didn't give to us.
This really hasn't come up at all in all the conversations about all this. I think it was their sincere attempt to give us everything that they've done and to realize the significance of having it complete or as complete as possible. The other thing, in addition to what Jennifer said, was that we really don't have everything yet because they're both still alive, and Massimo has been producing work right up to the present, and so there's going to be more work coming in into the center. I know this probably scares Jennifer to realize that she's got more to deal with, but I think a good deal of their contemporary work, a lot of their newer work, which has been done in digital format, will be added to the collection.